see everyone here today. And if you've got a bulletin and looked at it, you know that Ray is away preaching a homecoming service today up at Batcave, North Carolina. He did ask me to remind everybody that if you do need to reach him, just call him on his regular phone. Do not use the bat phone. Just use your regular, his regular number will be fine. You also see some other announcements in your bulletin about some upcoming events in July, especially for our youth. So as you look through that, please make note of that. And also look at our prayer requests that are listed as well. You also notice in your bulletin a yellow sheet. This is, I think, the third time that we've, since we've changed our deacon election process. And so let me just go over a few things with you about the process and hopefully answer any questions that you might have or might be thinking about. As we do this each year, remember that members of the church can nominate men who are 21 years or older, who are also members of the church, who they think would make good deacons. They can nominate them. Now, we don't do like we used to, where, you know, people would raise your hand and say, hey, take my name off. We'll worry about all that after the nominations are complete. And if a person or a man of the church is nominated, he will be contacted and have an opportunity to say, yes, I would like to serve, or yes, I'd like to talk more about it, or no, please take my name off. So we don't do that at this point. And we're going to be nominating men for candidates for deacon for the next few weeks up through the last Sunday of July. So take this sheet today and just study it, pray about it, look through it, you know, and contemplate, meditate, and pray about it. And the other thing I need to make mention of, this sheet is not 100% complete. So we'll have it updated to make sure that every male member of the church, 21 years or older, is included on the list. Lee Broom was looking through it this morning and he noticed there might be a couple of names that should be on there that are not. So he and the pastor and the deacons, they'll make sure that every person who is eligible, that their name appears on there. So keep that in mind. We'll be going through this nomination process pretty much for the rest of the month of July. Now, with all that being said, I think that covers all of the regular announcements for today. So let's continue now with our worship. And let's look at our opening song this morning, and that's our doxology. So let's stand and sing together as we worship the Lord.
Praise God, God.
Continue singing, so if you'll please remain standing. And one announcement I did fail to mention this morning is that Thomas is going to be preaching again for us, so we're definitely blessed and grateful that he could come and share with us again this morning as he gets ready to prepare for his time at seminary, which will begin in just a few weeks. But so thank you, Thomas, for helping us out today. Our next song is actually 539, not 593, and that's My Faith Looks Up to Thee. And we're going to sing verses 1 and 2 of My Faith Looks Up to Thee.
Savior divine, now
offering time, we're going to do an old, not that old of a song, but it just seems like it is, Surely Goodness and Mercy, a John Peterson song. And we'll do all three verses, and then it'll be time for our morning offering. So let's sing together, Surely Goodness and Mercy.
To come in our house and worship you this morning. And dear Lord, we pray that that's exactly what we would do, is that we would truly worship you, that we would hear the words that would be said, dear Lord, and we would apply into our life and to our hearts, and that we might go out here and serve you better each and every day of our lives. Dear Lord, thank you for the abundance you give us. We're a blessed people. Sometimes we don't act like it, but we are a blessed people. Help us to remember each and every blessing you give us, dear Lord, and help us to never take anything that you give us for granted. Dear Lord, as we bring a portion back to thy house, we pray that we would give what we give with willing hearts, with a kind and generous heart, dear Lord, because we can't outgive you. You gave us everything. You loved us so much that you gave your only begotten Son, that he would die on a cruel cross that we'd be saved from our sins, and we can never repay you for that. Thank you for each blessing, dear Lord, as we go through the day. Help us to make good decisions and be pleasing in thy sight, dear Lord, and help us to do the things that you'd have us to do. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Christ things this morning, one announcement that I should have pointed out or I failed to mention, and that was this past Wednesday night. We were very fortunate to have our friend Judith here share with us about her ministry in Kenya and the orphanage that she runs and works at there in the nation of Kenya. And we were very blessed and learned a lot about what she does there and how that ministry and mission came about. So we're very grateful to you for sharing that with us, and we're so glad that you can spend some time with us here while you're visiting in the States. So thank you so much for that.
Jesus, Jesus, name.
Ephesians chapter 2. While you're doing that, let me go ahead and give you the scoop on what is going on this week. So, my dad pulls up in the yard last Sunday evening while me and Cooper are getting ready to go fishing. And he says, guess who's preaching next Sunday? I said, who? He said, you. I said, call the preacher. I said, okay. So I call him, and he tells me that there's been a miscommunication about what Sunday he's preaching this homecoming service. And he wants to know if I can preach this week. Now, under a normal circumstance, a week is enough notice. But I was going to be out of town all week. So I figured, as inexperienced as I am and having less time to write a sermon, less time to practice this sermon, I better preach out of a text that I've spent some time in. So, we're in Ephesians 2. Now, I've referenced some part of this scripture almost every time that I've talked, and I figured I might as well just preach a full sermon on it this morning. If you're wondering how I've come up with this title, it's because the text we're going to look at today shows us what we could refer to as the bad news, and then it shows us what is most certainly the good news, and then there are a couple of verses that show how God is glorified through it all. Now, here's my introductory claim before we get started. My claim this morning is that society could not be more confused about our original spiritual condition. Why is that? Well, we fail to focus on the Bible to answer the questions that arise in our life. And it's actually worse than that. I think many people have stopped consulting the Bible to even see how we should approach life in a general sense. Now, it's risky business when we start doing that, because when we throw out the guidebook, some questionable things start to influence people's lives or start to influence our thoughts. You turn on the TV and you see Keeping Up with the Kardashians and you say, I'm not that talented. I've got the ability to be incredibly selfish. I could have plastic surgery. That's it. I'm moving to Los Angeles. I'm going to be the biggest TV star ever. Or maybe you're a real man's man, and that sort of thing doesn't appeal to you, but you get in the truck, and you turn on some classic country, and there's Toby Keith singing, I Should Have Been a Cowboy. You get to thinking, that does sound pretty nice. I bet I could ride a horse. I mean, I've never done it before, but I could probably do it. I could sit and eat by the campfire, and a pretty woman would probably come along and run me down. I mean, I have watched Tombstone before. That's what happened to Wyatt Earp. You say, yep, that's it. I'm going to sell the house. I'm going to sell the car. I'm going to hitchhike out west, track down a wild stallion, and I'll be good to go. Now, I'll admit those are some rather extreme examples, but there's a very serious principle here. If the text in this book isn't in charge of your thoughts, your actions, the course you pursue for your life, your view on doctrine, your view on theology, your endeavors into finding out more about who God is, then what is in charge of that? Because society is happy to serve you a whole host of ideas that run contrary to the Word of God, and when you let the ideas that society promotes seep into your way of thinking, you quickly get confused. Some of the most elementary questions about Christianity start to become difficult for you to answer in a biblical fashion. Like, why do I need salvation? Where does salvation come from? How can I be assured of my salvation? What is the gospel? Now, today's scripture provides a biblical answer for all those questions, and that is what I aim to show you today. Let's pray, and then we'll get started. Dear God, we thank you for this day, this opportunity to be here and worship you. God, we've now arrived at the time when your word is preached, and I pray that you would bless the preaching of it. Will the things that I say not be heard today, but Father, will the things that the Holy Spirit speaks be what is heard? God, you brought us to a very glorious scripture this morning, and I pray that you would help us to see what you have stored for us within it. So in Jesus' name I pray, amen. Now start in verse 1 of Ephesians chapter 2, and I'm going to read through verse 3, and we'll stop and talk about it. And you were dead in your trespasses and sins in which you previously lived, according to the ways of this world, according to the ruler of the power of the air, the Spirit, now working in the disobedient. We too all previously lived among them in our fleshly desires, carrying out the inclinations of our flesh and thoughts, and we were by nature children under wrath, as others were also. Ephesians chapter 2 starts off by saying, you were dead. And you say, well, I don't feel very dead. I don't remember a time my heart has stopped beating. I've held my breath before, but it wasn't for that long. So what does dead mean? Well, what Paul's talking about here is spiritual life. And when he says that you were dead, It means that prior to salvation, there is no meaning in your spiritual life. A person who is unsaved is totally separated from God. You say separated by what? Well, the Bible says separated by trespasses and sins. Now, I know that y'all know what trespassing is. There are way too many country folks in here for me to spend time defining what trespassing is. I think most of y'all are probably qualified to give me lessons on trespassing. But I do want us to take a look at sin this morning, because I think sin is one of those words that we assume that we know what it means, whether we really do or not. And we've got this tendency to glance right past it. We've got this tendency when we come across it in our Bibles not to stop and study it. We might hear a preacher talk about it and it just rolls off our backs because we're very used to it. But I want us to take a moment to pause and consider what sin is. To do that, let's look at Psalm 51, verse 4. Now, the title of this psalm reveals its context. The title in my Bible says, A Psalm of David when the prophet Nathan came to him after he had gone to Bathsheba. Your translation might be a little more specific than that, but the CSB manages to keep it PG-13. Look at verse 4. David says, Against you, you alone, I have sinned and done this evil in your sight. Now, his words here are addressed to God. He makes that very, very clear in verse 1. So you've got David saying, God, against you, you only have I sinned. And if you're familiar with this event in David's life, you're left scratching your head. You say, Do what now, David? You lust after a woman that you spotted from the top of your palace. You have her brought to you. She's identified as Uriah the Hittite's wife, and he's one of your 30 best soldiers ever. But you sleep with her anyway. You get her pregnant. And realizing that you either have to face the music or try to cover it up, you say, Let me try to cover this up. So you bring Uriah home from the battlefield and try to tell him to go to his house and stay with his wife, but he won't cooperate. He refuses to go to his house while his fellow soldiers are at war. So David's cover-up attempt, number one, is a failure, so he has to turn to plan B. David sends Uriah back to the battlefield and gives him a letter to deliver to Joab, who was the general. The letter he's carrying says, Put Uriah at the front of the fiercest fighting, then withdraw from him so that he is struck down and dies. Uriah was carrying with him his very own death sentence. He delivers it to Joab, and Joab obeys the orders. They were in battle, and Joab led the troops up to a city way closer to the wall of the city than standard military practice called for. He made sure that Uriah was right in the thick of the fighting, and then he withdrew all the men back and left Uriah there for dead. The news makes it back to David. It's pretty easy to see that he does not really care. Uriah's wife mourns for a little while, but then she moves back in with David and bears the child that they conceived in adultery. Now, you look at all that. You look at David's lust, David's adultery, David's attempt to cover up the truth, David's murder of one of his best soldiers, and you say, Now, David, you are crazy. You say that you sinned against God and God only, but you did wrong to a whole lot more people than God. And David, you committed a whole lot of immoral actions, and a lot of them were committed against other people. But what David wrote here in Psalm 51:4 is true. It has to be. It was inspired by God himself. You see, sin isn't just doing wrong. Sin isn't just a moral activity. Sin is the preference of anything else over your relationship with God. The preference of anything else of your relationship with God. Now, David knew that sleeping with another man's wife was going to hinder his relationship with God, but he did it anyway. David knew that the right thing to do in God's eyes would be to own up to his actions, but he did his very best to pull the wool over Uriah's eyes. David knew that murdering one of his best soldiers wasn't the way God had decreed the kingship to function, but he did not hesitate to have Uriah killed. Maybe you're not out there stealing other people's spouses and having their mate killed, but there is a way and a place and a time in every person's life in which they have prioritized something else over their relationship with God. In Psalm 16:11, we see that in God's presence there is fullness of joy and pleasures forever. But you see, we're sinners. That's not good enough for us. I guarantee you at some point in your life, your actions have shown that you think there is something in the world that can give you more joy than God can. I guarantee you that at some point in your life, your actions have shown that you think there is some worldly pleasure that is more fulfilling are longer lasting or more intense than the pleasure which God can give you. And I'll make you one more guarantee. If you're not saved, as you're sitting here this morning, if you're not in a relationship with Jesus Christ where he's the Lord and you're the servant, then I guarantee you that you are still living life like you think there's a source of joy that is greater than the joy that comes from God. Or like there's a pleasure out there somewhere that can surpass the pleasure as in the presence of God. Let's pick back up in Ephesians at the beginning of verse 2. And it says, in which you previously lived. Now that is talking about your old life of sin. It goes on to say, according to the ways of this world, according to the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit now working in the disobedient. I think we can all agree that the ways of this world is another way of saying worldliness. That's fairly easy to see. Now, I think that we can all say that we understand worldliness to be sin. But what about the ruler of the power of the air? Who is that? What about the spirit now working in the disobedient? What is that? Let's take the spirit now working in disobedient, the very last phrase. And I'm sure that many of you today are reading out of the King James Version or the New King James Version or maybe at ESV. And I'm glad you are, because I love how those translations translate the end of verse 2. They say something like, the spirit now at work in the sons of disobedience. And that phrase, sons of disobedience, makes the cross reference that I'm about to use incredibly easy and incredibly obvious for us to see. So I want us to look over at John 8. It should be coming up on the screen. You don't have to turn over because we're going to be in Ephesians still. Let's look at John 8 and see who is the father of these sons of disobedience. I'll pick up in verse 34. Jesus responded, truly I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave of sin. A slave does not remain in the household forever, but a son does remain forever. So if the son sets you free, you really will be free. I know that you were descendants of Abraham, but you are trying to kill me because my word has no place among you. I speak what I have seen in the presence of the Father, so then you do what you have heard from your father. Our father is Abraham, they replied. Jesus says, if you were Abraham's children, you would do what Abraham did. But now you're trying to kill me, a man who has told you the truth that I heard from God. Abraham did not do this. You're doing what your father does. We weren't born of sexual immorality, they said. We have one father, God. Jesus said to them, if God were your father, you would love me because I came from God and I am here. For I didn't come on my own, but he sent me. Why don't you understand what I say? Because you cannot listen to my word. You are of your father the devil, and you want to carry out your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he tells a lie, he speaks from his own nature because he is a liar and the father of lies. Yet because I tell you the truth, you do not believe me. Now in John 8, Jesus makes it very plain and very clear that the people who are opposing him, the people who he says are trying to have him killed, they're not the children of God, but that they are the children of Satan, or the sons of disobedience. So let's go back to Ephesians 2 and look at the implications of this. Verse 2 says, according to the ways of this world, according to the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit now working in the disobedient. So you lived just like the people of this world. You were under the control of Satan. You were exactly like the children of Satan. You say, I don't get this, I'm lost, this doesn't make sense. Well, what Paul is doing under the inspiration of God is he's adding another piece to the puzzle. He's giving you a clearer picture of your spiritual situation prior to salvation. He's already said in verse 1 that you were completely separated from God. And now he takes verse 2 and he says, but you and Satan, you were like this. You were tight. And Paul's going to add to that one more time in verse 3. He starts off verse 3 and says, we too. Who was this letter written to? Chapter 1, verse 1 tells me, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by God's will, to the faithful saints in Christ Jesus at Ephesus. Seems pretty clear to me that he's talking to people who are now Christians. It says, we too all previously lived among them. That's the sons of disobedience. In our fleshly desires, carrying out the inclinations of our flesh and thoughts. The inclinations of our flesh and our thoughts are not good things. There is no inherent righteousness or wisdom in them, and I think I can prove that to you this morning. So, one summer toward the end of high school, a bunch of us guys were hanging out over my buddy Matthew's house. Now, Matthew's family had a pool, so naturally that was the place to be in the summer. One evening, we're out there, and it starts to get late, and a couple of us had to leave. So as we're leaving, the in-pool shenanigans kind of come to an end. So the guys that are left behind start looking for something to do. Now, at this point, I'm not there, so I'm going to pass along the rest of this story as it was passed along to me. But knowing my friends as I did in that stage of our lives, I have no doubt that this is exactly what happened. So my buddy Matthew speaks up and he says, "Let's play four-wheeler dodgeball." Now, if you're a civilized person, let me explain to you what four-wheeler dodgeball is. Four-wheeler dodgeball is where you've got people throwing balls and you got people riding four-wheelers. The object of the game is to hit the people on the four-wheeler with the ball while they're driving the four-wheeler. How could that ever go badly? So the only rule of the game is that there are certain boundaries laid out that the people on four-wheelers can't go outside of. So they start playing four-wheeler dodgeball and everything's going just swell, or I guess as swell as things can go when you're playing four-wheeler dodgeball. And all of a sudden, Matthew is on a four-wheeler, and he's a little too focused on the people throwing the balls and not very focused on where he's driving. So the other people see what's coming, and they start screaming, and he looks up totally in vain and tries to hit the brakes, and he absolutely slams right into the side of our buddy's brand-new truck. Now, the guy that got his truck hit was about to have a heart attack. One of the other guys was about to have a heart attack because he was laughing so hard. And Matthew almost got killed simply because his mom almost killed him. Now, if that story doesn't suggest that the human mind is a messed up thing and comes up with some messed up ideas, I'm not really sure how else to convey it. Let's finish up verse 3. It says, "And we were by nature children under wrath as the others were also." It says, we were born sinners. Psalm 51:5 says, "Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me." You see, we are just as guilty as the people of this world. We deserve to spend eternity in hell just as much as the sons of disobedience. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fallen short of God's glorious standard." Romans 6:23 says, "For the wages of sin is death." By nature. That's just who we were. That's just how we were born. Now, up until this point, everything that I've said describes every person in this room at some point or another. See, we've all been unrepentant sinners at one point or another. We've all lived like the world at some point or another. We've all carried out the desires of our flesh at one point or another. And believe it or not, we've all done something as stupid as play four-wheeler dodgeball at some point or another. Unfortunately, I bet all of us have done something much stupider. Because the desires of our flesh, the inclinations of our thoughts, have led us to do things that had serious consequences. We've caused significant harm to ourselves. We've caused significant harm to the people around us. We've sown hurt when we should have sown love. We've pushed away the good and replaced it with bad. Now, that's an accurate description of every one of us here today at some point in our lives, but we're about to come to a dividing point. Verses 4 and 5. It says, "But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love that he had for us, made us alive with Christ, even though we were dead in trespass." You were saved by grace. The division is that there are saved people here today, and there are unsaved people here today. And in an effort to spell out what salvation is, how it works, who makes it happen, let's look into verses 4 and 5. Verse 4 starts off, "But God." You want to know who makes salvation work? There's your answer. That did not take too long. Simply put, the answer is God. John chapter 6, verse 44 says, "No man can come to me unless the Father who sent me draw him, and I will raise him up on the last day." There's absolutely nothing that any person can do to manufacture their own salvation in and of themselves. If you need help wrapping your head around that idea, just look back at verse 1. Verse 1 says, "You were dead." Now, I don't know about you, but I've never seen a dead person that could do anything. And if physically dead people can't do anything, what makes you think that us, as spiritually dead people, have the ability to produce our own salvation apart from the hand of God? Verse 4 says, "But God, who is rich in mercy." Now, a working definition for mercy this morning, let's just say, is not getting what you do deserve. Not getting what you do deserve. Why does God show Christians mercy? It says because of his great love that he had for us. You see, God loves us. But God's love isn't like humans' love. God's love isn't conditional. It's not based on the fact that we're great people or that we're beautiful or we're fun to be around or that we give him gifts. On the contrary, God's love is completely unmerited. Romans 3, verses 10 through 12 says, there is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned away. All alike have become worthless. There is no one who does what is good, not even one. Now, that does not paint a very pleasant picture of humanity. That does not show us to be as lovable as we sometimes think that we are. So what did God do since we're so sinful, yet he loved us anyway? It says that he made us alive with Christ, even though we were dead in trespasses. Now, I think that the word with, as it's used here, can mean two things, both of which are biblical. The first thing I think it means here is in accordance with, or in the same manner as. God made us alive in accordance with Christ. God made us alive in the same manner as he made Christ alive. In Peter's sermon on Pentecost, he references God making Christ alive. Acts 2, verses 23, 24 says, though he's talking about Jesus, was delivered up according to God's determined plan and foreknowledge, you used lawless people to nail him to a cross and kill him. God raised him up, ending the pains of death because it was not possible for him to be held by death. See, there's no doubt about it. Jesus had been killed. As Jesus' body was laid in that tomb, it was as dead could be. In a similar manner, the bond between you and the world was strong. Your leader was Satan. The desires of your flesh dominated your life. You were by your very nature a child under wrath. There's no doubt about it, you were spiritually dead. But as Jesus laid in that tomb, as the sun was coming up on Sunday morning, the hand of God moved and made his body alive again. And as you, completely bonded by sin, totally under the influence of Satan, were a lost wanderer chasing your own desires, the hand of God moved and gave you spiritual life. Here's the second thing that I think with means here. I think that with means by way of. God made us alive by way of Christ. Christ was the means by which we gained life. So what I've got for you today is a picture of you and your relationship with God prior to salvation. If you're not a saved person here, this is a current picture of you and your relationship with God. Totally separated. Totally separated by the very nature of who we are compared to the very nature of who God is. Now, because we are sinful, unholy, unjust people, but we were created by a perfect, holy, and just God, what we've done is earned ourselves punishment. But say God made us alive with Christ, so enter the perfect sacrifice of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ had a divine nature, yet he was in a human body. He was God and man at the same time. And when Jesus bled in the praetorium, when Jesus hung on the cross and bled and suffocated to death, what he did was wipe away our punishment. And by wiping away our punishment, what Jesus has done is made us a way back to Christ, back to a relationship with God. End of verse 5 says, you are saved by grace. And if you recall, we talked about mercy just a minute ago, and I told you that mercy is not getting what you do deserve. Well, grace is exactly the opposite. Grace is receiving what you don't deserve. Now, I could come up with a story to try and illustrate grace. I could break out a Bible dictionary, try to read you a definition of grace, and both of those would be fine things to do. But if you really want to understand what grace is, all you need to do is look at the paradox that we've covered so far. See, verses 1 through 3 spelled out how we were spiritually dead. Our lives were worldly. We were tightly associated with Satan. We lived exactly like everybody else. We were under wrath. Then you get to verse 4, and gosh, there's something, everything changes. We're shown mercy. We're loved. We're made alive. We're saved. And you're left wondering, how does this group of people turn into this group of people? The answer is, by the grace of God. That's the best example of grace I can give to you this morning. Verse 6 says, he also raised us up with him, seated us with him in the heavens in Christ Jesus. Now, your ability to comprehend this verse relies on your ability to see the word in that is positioned in front of Christ Jesus at the end of this verse. Because you see, we aren't literally in heaven right now. You're not literally there. I think you can sense that most clearly. But this verse says that Jesus Christ is in heaven right now. Let's look at what that means to us. Verse 6 clearly says that being raised up, being seated in heaven with Christ is dependent on a person's life being in Christ Jesus. So is your present life being lived in Christ? Because if so, your eternal life will be in Christ also. Is your present identity in Christ? Because if so, your eternal identity will be in Christ. But take heed. If your present life is being lived apart from Christ, then you will spend eternity apart from Christ as well. If your present identity is not in Christ, then don't expect to dwell with Christ in eternity. It says, he also raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavens in Christ Jesus, so that, this is the reason for it, this is why we have been saved, so that in the coming ages he might display the immeasurable riches of his grace through his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. There's nothing more that God could do that would show how gracious he is than for him to save sinners like us. And that's exactly what he has done. Go back to verses 1 through 3 and look at where we were. We didn't bring anything to the table. We had nothing to offer God. We had no claim to make towards our worthiness. But God, in his mercy, fueled by his love, came down from heaven and walked among us. In the body of Jesus of Nazareth. He lived a perfect life. He shed his blood. He died. He did exactly what had to be done to reconcile us to himself. And that exchange of his righteousness for our guilt displays the glory of God infinitely more than it reflects anything positive on the part of man. The work of salvation glorifies God. Now we're coming up on some of the greatest verses in the Bible right here, in my opinion. Verse 8 starts off and says, for you are saved by grace through faith. Grace is receiving something that you don't deserve. I told you that just a second ago. And God's actions to take Christians from where we were in verses 1 through 3 and reconcile us to himself were not mandatory. Nobody earned that. Nobody deserved it. Our salvation is a gift from God. When you come to the word faith, what is faith? Now, last week, I got all sophisticated on you, pulled out my concordance, started going over the Greek definition and stuff, trying to demonstrate what belief slash understanding slash faith is. But this week, I'm going to keep it a little more simple. Probably the most straightforward definition of faith in the Bible comes to us from Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. It says, now, faith is the reality of what is hoped for, the proof of what is not seen. A definition of faith holds true even in a secular society. When people use the word faith in a conversation, this is generally what they mean. This past spring, I was eating in the cafeteria with a group of football guys. And two of them got up to go get something else to eat. And they came back and told us, they said, that manager over there is absolutely raking that cook over the coals. Said he told him he made way too much chicken. Nobody's ever going to eat all that chicken. It's 12:30. The lunch crowd's already left. And he keeps going on and on and on. The whole time he's throwing these little off-color comments. I mean, he was really trying to humiliate the guy. So these guys come back to the table. They tell us all this. And we're all sitting around, pretty much finished eating, trying to decide if we want ice cream or not. But as soon as we heard all this, every one of us got up and went up there and got 3 or 4 pieces of this chicken. And another group of guys walked in, and they come over. They start talking to us. And we said, y'all got to go get some of this chicken. It's phenomenal today. So pretty soon, we have destroyed this whole pan of chicken that was up on the counter. And the guys had to break out the extra chicken that the manager tried to tell him was going to be wasted. Now, that's a pretty silly example, but that example shows faith. Because when the guys came to the table and said the manager had chewed out the cook, we believed that they were being serious. It was a reality to us. Our actions proved that we took what they had said seriously, because we were all done eating, but based on this new information, we went and found a way to eat some more chicken. Now, there's one more very interesting thing that happened because we had faith in what those guys had said. Our appetites changed. See, I wanted ice cream. I was going to get some ice cream. But when I heard this news, I said, I want some chicken. Now, you're probably thinking this is the stupidest illustration that's ever been used in a pulpit ever. That could probably be true. But watch this. You can't have faith in the gospel and still have an appetite for the things that the Bible said about humans in verses 1 through 3. You can't truly understand how merciful God is and say, that's awesome, but I like my trespasses and sins better. You can't truly see the love of God and say, that's incredible, but I still want to be just like the rest of the world. You can't truly comprehend salvation, the salvation God has extended to you, and say, you know, I think I'm going to just keep following Satan's lead. Because those responses show that you don't have faith. They testify that the gospel is not a reality to you. And they do show proof that you failed to place your trust in the finished work of Jesus Christ. Because if you believe that Jesus really is who he said he was, that has consequences. If you really believe that Jesus can save you, then that is going to change your life. So we see what faith is. Now, how do we obtain faith? It says, for you are saved by grace through faith, and this is not of yourselves, as the gift of God. We've already seen that the ability to be transformed from a sinner under the wrath of God to a person with a relationship with God comes from God. That is done by God. It is Christ who paid for the punishment we deserve. It is Christ who allows us to be reconciled with God. But in the same way, the very ability to believe comes from God. Because you see, you were dead in your trespasses and sins. You lived just like everyone in the world. You were under the power of Satan. You were completely blind. You did not understand your spiritual position. You didn't understand your need for salvation. Now, surely you know what it's like to be blinded from reality. I think we all get a little blind from reality sometimes. One day after school, some of my buddies walked into the Wing King up here in New York. I'm pretty sure it was like the exact same guys that were playing four-wheeler dodgeball. But they saw this guy that we went to school with. And let me tell you, this guy was a character. But they walk up to him and he's sitting there and said, hey man, what are you doing? He said, well, I'm applying for a job up here, but I don't really know what position I should put. So they get to talking about it. He says, well, I don't want to be a cook and I don't really think I'd be a good waiter. And they go on and on and on. So they say, hey man, why don't you apply to be the doorman? He says, the Wing King doesn't have a doorman. And they said, exactly. The Wing King needs a doorman. So about a week later, they're all eating lunch, and this guy comes up mad, and he says, I can't believe it. The Wing King hasn't called me back. I said, well, what'd you end up applying for? And he said, the doorman. You see, the prospect of this guy getting a job, it blinded him so badly that he couldn't see that applying to be the doorman at a restaurant that didn't have a doorman was a really bad idea. Or what about American Idol? I'd watch American Idol when I was younger, but I haven't cared about it at all in a good little while now. And you know why that is? It's because the contestants got a lot better. You say, now, why would you stop watching a singing show because the singing got better? Because I only watched it so I could see the people sing who thought they could sing that really couldn't sing. They'd get up there with their own original song. They'd say, you know, I've been told I sound like Mariah Carey. I'm going to be the next Michael Jackson. And they get up there and sing their heart out, and it is terrible. So terrible that it's actually comical. But see, they were so convinced of the fact that they were a good singer that they didn't even notice that the judges were laughing at them the whole time they were singing. Now look at the spiritual situation of the unsaved. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 3 and 4. It says, but if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this age has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. Now compare that to Ephesians chapter 2. Corinthians says, but if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. Ephesians says, and you were dead in your trespasses and sins. That sounds like us. It says, in their case, the God of this age, that is Satan, has blinded the minds of unbelievers. Ephesians 2 says, we were under the power of Satan. Were we unbelievers? Yes, absolutely. We were by nature children under wrath. No one is born a Christian. You didn't come into this world a believer. There's been a time in all of our lives where we were an unbeliever. And God had to give us eyes that could see. God has to give us a heart that can understand. God has to take the veil off our face, or we'll stay blind to the glory of Christ forever. So in light of this, what can we boast about when it comes to our salvation? You are saved by grace through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It's God's gift, not from works, so that no one can boast. Oh, we can't boast about anything. Verse 10 says, for we are his workmanship. God is the one who has done the work. We are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus. Notice it doesn't say we were restored. It doesn't say we were renovated. It doesn't say our old nature was improved upon. Those of us who are in Christ are a brand new creation. 2 Corinthians 5:7 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, and see, the new has come. So if you're a Christian, you're not stuck in that life of verses 1 through 3, the way that it describes it. God's made you into the creation that is described in verses 4 through 10. And he made you into that creation out of nothing. It says you were a new creation. So finally, comes to the end of verse 10. Why has God done this? We are created in his workmanship in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared ahead of time for us to do. Now, good works do not earn your salvation, but good works do show your salvation. The followers of Jesus do bear fruit. The followers of Jesus do obey the commands of Jesus. The followers of Jesus are going to magnify the glory of God on this earth through their actions. The love of God that saves your soul will also change your life. Now, towards the beginning of my sermon, I said that many Christians are experiencing confusion when it comes to answering some of the most basic questions of Christianity in a biblical fashion. But the text that we have looked at this morning has addressed every one of those questions. Why do I need salvation? Well, you need salvation because you were absolutely dead without it. The presence of sin in your life has separated you from God before you even exited the womb. There's nothing worthy about you. You have no case on your own for why you deserve eternal life. Where does salvation come from? Simply put, salvation comes from God. Salvation is a result of God opening our eyes. Salvation is a result of God changing our heart. Salvation is a result of God creating a brand new us that is in Christ Jesus. How can I be assured of my salvation? The assurance of your salvation lies in the root of your salvation. Philippians 1, verse 6 says, I am sure of this, that he who started a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Jesus Christ. See, because salvation comes from God, my salvation doesn't hinge on my faithfulness to God. It hinges on God's faithfulness to me, and God is faithful. But don't take that and run with it. Don't take that out of context. Don't say that because I found $5 in the pocket of the pants I wore last week, that certainly shows God's presence in my life. I'm going to heaven. I'm eternally secure. Because verse 10 just said that truly saved people are going to live like they're truly saved people. So don't ever worry about the security of your salvation, because the security of saved people's salvation is as secure as anything ever could be. But if you have a burden about the issue, if you're genuinely concerned about the state of your soul, then ask yourself instead, is my salvation
legitimate? That's a question that you answer by taking stock of your life. Maybe start with the question, have I absolutely surrendered my life to Jesus? What is the gospel? If you can't look at this text and see the gospel, I don't really think there's anything I can do to show it to you. The fact that God can take people from being sin-loving, trespassing, worldly, Satan-following, flesh-satisfying people under his very own wrath, and he can show them mercy, he can love them, he can make them alive, he can give them eyes to see, he can give them hearts to understand, he can save us from everything we have earned. If that's not good news, then I don't really know what it is. If that's not the gospel of the glory of Christ, then I can't really tell you where to find it. So I'm about to close right now, but I've got a question for you. You see, I intentionally didn't comment on a few vital words in the text today because I wanted to save them for this moment. So would you look at your Bible or look at the screen, starting in verse 1 of Ephesians 2. It says, "And you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you previously lived, according to the ways of this world, according to the ruler of the power of the air, the Spirit, now working in the disobedient." We too, all previously lived among them in our fleshly desires, carrying out the inclinations of our flesh and thoughts, and we were by nature children under wrath, as others were also. So the question is, did you previously live just like the world does? Or do you still live just like the world does? Did you used to fulfill the desires of your flesh and carry out whatever your thoughts told you to do? Or do you still fulfill the desires of your flesh and do the things that your thoughts tell you to do? That all culminates to this last question. Were you a child under wrath, or are you still a child under wrath? Now, maybe you're sitting here this morning and the grace of God has fallen upon you. And maybe God has used something that has happened here this morning to open your eyes or to cause you to comprehend his glory. Maybe for the first time in your life, you truly understand your need for salvation. Maybe you've realized that Jesus can change your life. If that's you, then I urge you to respond to that. I'm going to pray. We're going to sing. And while we're singing, if there's a burden on your heart this morning, then you desperately need to do something about it. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you again for this text. We thank you again for the ability to come in your house and to hopefully hear a word from you. God, I thank you that you opened my eyes to see the bad news. I thank you that you showed me my need for salvation. And God, I'm thankful that you revealed to me the good news. I'm thankful that you revealed to me that you could take me from where I was and restore me to a relationship with you. And God, I am thankful at the very thought that I might, in the most insignificant of ways, be part of your plan, of your own glorification. Now, God, maybe there's someone here this morning who's seen the bad news for the first time, who has seen their need for salvation. Maybe there's someone here who has realized the good news, that you can save us. And God, maybe there's someone here who's willing to surrender their life and say, God, use me to glorify you however you see fit. God, if there's someone in here this morning, even one, God, who's experiencing that, I pray that you would draw them to yourselves in this time. It's in Jesus' name I pray and ask these things.
Hymn of invitation is 344, Grace Greater Than Our Sin. So let's stand together and sing.
you're a visitor and I haven't scared you off, I would just encourage you to come back. Sunday school starts at 9:50 every Sunday morning. We have a fellowship breakfast before that every week, and then obviously service at 11 every week. But thank y'all for being here this morning. I appreciate it. And Brother Ben, why don't you pray for us?
Sing our closing song as we close out our service.